Hello, my name is Danny Nolman and I'm the Director of ChassisSim Technologies. And welcome to this latest episode of Dan's Vehicle Dynamics Corner. Today, ladies and gentlemen, we've got a real treat for you. What we're going to be talking about is the differential and tuning it using ChassisSim. Now, to kick this tutorial off, I want to start with a quote that I saw in Carol Smith's Drive to Win many years ago. And the true significance of this quote never really hit me until only just a couple of years ago. And it was this quote when Carol was talking about differentials. "We have so much downforce that the diff is now irrelevant," and that was quoted by an F1 designer who has never won a race. And if I could have one quote that truly summarizes just how important the diff is, it's that quote right there. Because it doesn't matter whether you're running a spec Miata or whether you're running an F1 car or a P1 car. You ignore the diff at your own peril. And one of the things about the differential is it's a critical variable, but if I could look at all the setup variables of a race car that's ignored the most, the diff is actually would probably be number one on the list. But here's the thing about the diff. It has a big impact on the drivability and stability of the vehicle. It also because of the fact that when you install a diff into a car, getting it out is an operation that is bigger than Ben Hur. So consequently, we really need to have a good handling on the dynamics and metrics to consider. And then what we're then going to talk about is how to show you how to tune this in ChassisSim. So let's get started. Okay, here's a challenge posed by the differential. Because we have a four-wheeled vehicle, we've got an outside wheel, we've got an inside wheel, because as we traverse around the corner, the outside tire has got to be spinning faster than the inside tire. But here's the thing that throws the cat amongst the pigeons, particularly when we start pushing the car to the edge, and that is load transfer and how it affects the forces that we have available to us. Now, in terms of the types of differentials you're going to be playing with, the first type is the open diff. The thing about the open diff is it definitely solves the differential speed problem, and provided you're going to go nowhere near the traction circle radius, you're going to go nowhere near the traction limits of the tire, you're laughing. However, the millisecond you start doing this, it is absolutely awful under load transfer. It's the worst of all possible worlds coming together. The second type of diff you're going to be dealing with is a limited slip diff. Now, in particular, the clutch pack limited slip diff. And what you've got is that you've got a diff housing with some ramps that push against some clutches, and you can adjust those ramp angles to adjust the appropriate locking ratio of the diff. It's not particularly sophisticated, but you can get a fair way down the road. Then there's diffs like the torsen torque sensing diff, which is actually a very, very clever but intricate device. But again, like with all diffs, the problem with it, and the limited slip diff definitely falls into this category, once it's installed in the car, getting it out can be an absolute nightmare. And to any prospective race engineers or any prospective data engineers watching this, I guarantee you, if you get your diff set up wrong, you will definitely destroy your popularity amongst the mechanics, because with even someone like an F3 car, getting a diff out is a 2 to 3 hour. Getting a diff out, it can be a 1.5 hour job if you are lucky, and that is if all the balls fall into play. Then there's the lock diff. Now, the lock diff is a classic case of cracking an egg with a sledgehammer. Under very, very high power loads, it's certainly bulletproof because the inside and the outside tire are locked together. The price you pay for that is god loads of understeer. But hell, to quote one of my V8 supercar customers, if that's good enough for John Deere, well, it's good enough for us. And then there's the electronic diff. Now, as we're going to discuss, as we'll discuss in a little bit, the electronic, let's put it this way, it's no accident that F1 teams and P1 teams spend an awful lot of effort trying to get their electronic diffs right, because it's the closest that you'll come to getting that ideal force distribution that you want. So there's a lot of significant cheddar to be had there. Unfortunately, it's banned for most categories of motor racing. Okay, so in order to be able to tune the diff, we've got to have some metrics in which to describe differential performance. So a diff mathematically can be described as the following. So what we've got here is that we've got an input force. What we've got is differential wheel speed. And this is the force that is split equally between from the wheel that is spinning the most to the wheel that is spinning the least. That's actually very, very significant. I'm going to talk about that in just a moment. The other metric that you've got to get your head around is the locking ratio of the diff, which is 100 times torque slow minus torque fast on torque total. That's actually a really important. That's actually a really important metric. That and that together is the mathematical language of a differential. Now, there are a couple of key metrics to keep in mind. The first is the max slip ratio of the inside rear tire. The differential velocity of your wheels can be approximated by your track times your electrical acceleration divided by your velocity. The implication of that is that your max slip ratio is going to be V plus T on R on 2 divided by V minus T times R on 2 minus 1. What does that mean in plain English? What that tells you is this is your absolute maximum upper limit of the slip ratio that your inside tire can go to. Go over that, and then all of a sudden, you fall on the other side of this where it starts to transfer torque from the outside tire into the inside tire, and that is a situation you do not want to be getting into. Okay, the other thing that we also have to keep in mind is there are two critical metrics with regards to diff performance that we've got to have a handle on. The first is the maximum slip ratio of the inside rear tire. This dictates what you can actually, this is your hard limit of how hard you can spin the inside rear tire, which is your slip ratio max is going to be V plus T T times R on 2 divided by V minus T time track times your rate on 2 minus 1. This is really, really critical because if you go over that, you fall into the situation where torque will be transferred from the outside tire to the inside rear tire, and this is somewhere where you just do not want to go. The other thing is the critical locking ratio. Now, the critical locking ratio determines what your your force distribution is, dictated to by the traction circle radius versus load characteristics of the tire and what the traction circle ellipse is doing. Now, as a rough rule of thumb, the critical ratio is the outside longitudinal force divided by the outside longitudinal force plus the inside longitudinal force minus 0.5, and the relation between the two is the critical ratio between critical ratio and the locking ratio is the locking ratio is 2 times the critical ratio. Now, I go into this in great depth in chapter 7 of my book, The Dynamics of the Racecar. So for those of you who are seeking to have a more proper mathematical treatment of this, I would really strongly refer you to that chapter, because I've had a number of my colleagues say to me that as far as they're concerned, there are two jewels of there are a number of jewels in that book. That chapter on diffs, particularly when I go into the mathematical formulation of where all this comes from, is a really, really important thing. So I would refer you to that. But here, ladies and gentlemen, is our challenge of the diff tuning. What we want to do is we're trying to optimize the force distribution to get it in line to what the tires want while keeping the inside tire spinning faster than the outside tire. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the real trick and where we're going to be expending an awful lot of our time, energy, and resources to do that. So, how do you do this using ChassisSim? Okay, so a couple of things to bear in mind. So what you'll do with ChassisSim, you'll go through, you'll put in your, set up your vehicle model. Now, if you click on the bell housing or the gearbox, you'll see here that in diff type, you've got a number of diff types to choose from. One is the open diff, two is the super diff, three is the lock diff, and 4 is the LSD. Now, to set up the LSD, all you've got to do is go into Access Properties Calculator, click Apply these settings to the diff, and you put in your locking ratio. So let's just say, for the sake of the argument, I'm going to put in 15%. And I will put in a bit of a free play on the wheel spin. It's more there to help ChassisSim solve for going down the straight to make sure the wheel's equalized in a straight line. But in terms of performance, it has zero impact. And when you click on OK, you'll wind up with a graphic that looks like this. Now, so what you'll do is you'll go through your car manual if you've got an LSD, and you'll see what the locking ratio is. I mean, as an example, Huland Extract should supply this information for you. Once you've got once you've got that, and you're going through and dialing in your steer correlation, a really important thing to do is to click on the rear tire, go to your tire model quick start, and go to apply slip angle ratio settings. And if you're finding that if you've got a very aggressive diff, but the steer isn't quite matching up, a big thing to play with is this max slip ratio. So for example, if I had a very aggressive diff, but I was hardly getting any induced understeer on the diff, as a rough rule of thumb, I would drop that max slip ratio to about 0.05 and click on OK to apply those settings. Now, what I've done here is I've loaded in a Dallara F310 car, and I've run a couple of simulations with it. I loaded up a default circuit willow bank, and I went through a couple of sims where I went through an open diff, a locked diff at a LSD at 10%, and the super diff option. Now, one of the great things about ChassisSim is that there are a couple of really good channels to help get your head around what the diff is doing. Now, what I'll do is I'll walk you through those. The first thing is that one of the things that ChassisSim will echo back is the applied longitudinal forces. It will also echo back what the wheel speeds are. And you can actually use this information to help you go in and define what you need from your limited slip diff. So you can feed this information back into this graph right here. And more importantly, let me show you what happened when I put in the limited slip diff at 10%. And let me put on the compare time for you. So as you can see, it certainly made up some time. It certainly made up some time here, about half a k an hour, and also to another half a k an hour here. Didn't quite like it in this low speed turn. But again, it's probably exploiting. But this is part of the problem of your standard lock slip diff. You have just a standard locking ratio in that, and that's it. Which again illustrates how much cheddar you can get with a limited slip diff. But the real payoff, ladies and gentlemen, is seeing what happens here in terms of your differential wheel forces. So all of a sudden here, let me just clarify that for you a little bit by just showing you the standard, what the limited slip diff looks like. So there, you've got your differential forces, you've got your wheel speeds that you can use to figure out your slip ratios. But more importantly, when you get into the traction element, you can now get to see what those differential wheel speeds are doing. That's really, really handy information. The other thing where this really shows its value is particularly when we put in the super diff option. And as you can see, the super diff option, all of a sudden you get to see some really big increases in terms of. Mid-corner speed, and particularly in terms of traction coming out of the corner. Now, the great thing about this is you can use this information of your wheel speeds here and your longitudinal forces here for the limited, for the super diff to give you a direction of where you need to be with this. That's actually something that's very, very powerful, ladies and gentlemen. And what you can do is in the data viewer of your choice, you can actually construct a 3D graph of differential wheel speed and your differential wheel speed, what your input forces are, and what your differential forces are, and you can view that as a graph and help you to define what you want out of your differential. That's actually a really, really powerful. That's actually a really powerful tool and a really great example about how you can use simulated data to feed back into helping you set up your race car. So, okay, some parting thoughts. Okay, first things first. The diff is a critical setup variable, and we ignore it at our peril. It's also one of these things that because it's so hard to change between sessions, that we've got to get it right. There are some pitfalls to be aware of, and we do walk a fine line between force distribution and slip management. Now, but the great news is, we can use ChassisSim to help us navigate through the jungle. However, don't take my word for it. If you're currently a member of the ChassisSim community, have a play with what we've just discussed. If you're not a member of the ChassisSim community, avail yourself of our online simulation and prove it to yourself. And we will catch you in the next episode of Dan's Vehicle Dynamics Corner.